I wanted to have a brief discussion, of lattice methods. These lattice models, before we continued with our analysis of the continuum. Studying these lattice models in high energy physics was very popular in the 1970s and 80s. And versions of it, of course, continue to be very popular in condensed matter physics. It's a useful thing to do. I actually, at some point, 10 years ago, I taught a whole course on this, these kind of things. So there's a lot of material. Okay? And I will not try to be systematic about it. Those are quite fun subjects. But, so now, I will briefly indicate various things that happen. So let me first start with the abelian. You remember how it went, right? We had this lattice. Okay, and we had variables that looked at these links. Do you remember what we call these variables? Call them phi. So let's say that link variables are labeled by the point you start out and the direction. Okay, and the final action, if you remember, is 1 by g squared, come back to 2, doesn't matter. Okay, 1 minus cosine of phi of, let's say that we're working in the the 1-2 direction. 1-2 direction will be sum of all directions, or the AB direction will be sum of all directions. So phi of x of any. Minus phi of x plus b a minus phi of x plus n a n b minus phi of x plus n a of x n b. Does this look familiar? It's slightly different relation. negative b derivative of AA. And this one discretizes the negative A derivative. A is the positive A derivative of AB. Okay? So this was our lattice cage theory. Okay. Now, in the last class, we very briefly looked at the strong coupling expansion. Right? We very briefly looked at the strong coupling expansion. So I'm just going to think of this model as a model in its own right. And the connection to the continuum theory will be later. Whatever. It's a model in its own right. And we very briefly looked at the continuum, strong coupling expansion. So G was very large. So 1 by G was very strong. Okay? And you saw that, for instance, we got this Wilson area law for the Wilson loops. More generally, if we wanted to compute the free energy of this theory, what we would do is bring down all terms from the action that don't give you zero in integration. But you can see that that is bringing down plaquettes in closed surfaces. So when we computed the Wilson loops, we had an open surface ending on the Wilson, because we had that insertion. But we have no insertion. If you bring down a plaquette, you have to bring down the neighboring plaquette and so on until you make a closed surface. Okay? So you see that the strong coupling expansion here is organized in a sum over surfaces. Okay? For every surface that you can draw on the lattice, there is a term. And the surfaces that are smaller and smaller contribute. Surfaces that are larger and larger contribute in an increasingly subdominant way in the strong coupling expansion. Okay? I'm not sure if anyone came in after I said this, but we came to the decision that evaluation in this course will be based just on assignments. I'm going to pad up the assignment set with 5 to 10 more problems. Okay? And 15th December is a hard deadline for submission. It's a hard deadline because I have to submit a grade soon after that. So, I mean, you're free to submit after that, but it won't come for you. Okay. So I'll give you a couple of problems from this lattice models seriously doing this strong coupling expansion. Okay. But now there is a qualitative feature here that I wanted to point out about the opposite expansion, namely the weak coupling expansion. Suppose we take this model and take G to be very small. Then, as I briefly mentioned in the last class, this is the limit in which this cosine, okay, does not want, the argument of the cosine does not want to deviate too far from zero. Because anything where this is large is highly suppressed. That's high action. Okay? If the cosine is not going to deviate too far from zero, then you can expand the cosine to quadratic order. You can use cos alpha is equal to 1 minus alpha squared 2. Okay, the 1's cancel. And the alpha squared by 2 then just give you the, you know, then you can, the, this is just this continuum, the discretization of the derivative. And so this just genuinely becomes the f squared action. Is this clear? Okay, except that I've done something wrong. One of my statements was wrong. Or was inaccurate. Can you identify which one? Okay, I'll tell you what statement. The statement was that when g is very small, you want to expand the cosine around zero. The argument of the cosine around zero. That was it. Why is that inaccurate?
We should expand it around g.
About?
G.
No. But the argument. We're doing saddle points, basically. So you look at the because cosine is a periodic function. So it's 0 is not different from 2 pi, or minus 2 pi, or 2 n. So really what you should do is to expand this around any of its 2 n pi. Okay? So really, you know, apart from this one factor, which is cancelled, okay, it's this, the right approximation for this cosine is not this quantity squared. So that's continuing about this quantity alpha. But instead is alpha minus 2n pi, the whole thing squared by 2. Sum over. Okay? Now, if your alpha happens to be in the neighborhood of one of the n's, the other terms are completely negligible. Okay? So, they being there makes no difference what you're doing.
So, we just pick out one term from the...
We'll just have the whole series. We keep the whole series because any one of them may turn out to be important. We don't know which one. Okay? Those terms that are not, where alpha is not near one of them, will contribute extremely subdominantly. But we'll just keep it. There's no harm in it. Okay? So, this whole 1 minus cosine here is well approximated by this, where n is a sum over all integers. Is this clear? Now, let us emphasize one thing. In this problem, these phi's here are taken to be periodic. Phi runs from 0 to 2 pi. Phi is a phase. It was the e to the power of phi. Okay? Now, this fact, even in the weak coupling limit, is very important. The fact that we are not allowed to take this object and to expand it entirely around just alpha equals here. And I want to try to explain why this is so important. The point is that if you just say that this is the case, okay? So you've got this cosine of, so what we've got is an e to the. The correct statement is this, that a small enough g, e to the power minus 1 by g squared of 1 minus cos alpha, okay, is approximately e to the power minus 1 by 2 g squared, sum over alpha minus n to the whole thing squared. 2 pi. Okay, fine. Okay? You see, if alpha is in the neighborhood of one of these points, the other ones are extremely subdominant.
Yeah. No, I was asking whether it is mathematically valid to be linear expansion of multiple points of shift there.
Well, this is the statement that you said.
Oh.
Right. So as long as this is true, that's all I'm doing. Okay. I have this up in my exponential, and I'm replacing it with this. Okay? Yeah. Now there is something here that I will only qualitatively indicate to you. And I will actually set you a problem in the problem set to try to make this precise. You see, these n's here live on faces. Okay. This alpha is approximately FAB. You know, flux due to the A field. If you discretize your phi, it's flux due to the A field. Okay. So what these N's are here are additional fluxes. Apart from the flux that you get from your A field, you can have additional integer values of fluxes running through each face. Okay? Now, you see, these additional fluxes have the following property. That suppose you take a little cube. Okay? Suppose I take a little hypercube. Let's say I'm in three dimensions. Okay, so I take a little hypercube. Okay. The flux that you get from just alpha has the property that if you sum the flux over all faces of the cube, you get zero. simply the discrete version of the statement that integral VA is equal to closeness. Okay, the flux that comes from alpha is built out of an A. Right, it's built out of this. This is this DA. And you can easily convince yourself, we could do it if you're interested. You could easily convince yourself that if you just sum the flux over this flux, where the flux is defined by this object, plus this phase, plus this phase, all the terms that you get here will just cancel. Okay? That's an easy exercise to do. And we could do it in 2 minutes, right? That's an easy exercise to do. Where does it come from? It comes from the fact that every particular link is shared between two faces. This link appears in the flux in this phase. It also appears in flux in this phase. Okay? And so if you do that sum with the appropriate orientations, each link just cancels it. Is this clear? In this one it comes like this, and in this one it goes like that. Okay? So just 1 minute of thinking about it will make this totally clear. That this sum over fluxes, the contribution from this part is just zero.
Sir, all this holds only for periodic boundary conditions.
Periodic boundary conditions for the lattice?
Yeah, I mean, if it's not periodic, then the ends won't necessarily calculate.
Yeah, yeah, if you've got something funny happening. But even if it was not periodic in the middle of the lattice, well, this is correct. Okay? However, there's no particular reason at all for the sum of our fluxes for these ends to be equal to 0. These ends are completely arbitrary integers. And the sum over ends over all faces of a cube can be anything you want. Okay? Now, this whole stuff can be processed as follows. You can take these n's, these integers, and rewrite them effectively as d of something, okay, plus a curl, okay, plus a part that contributes to basically this non-zero source for x. And the part where this n is d of something can just be absorbed into the alphas. Can be just absorbed into the phis. Because the alphas in themselves were d of the phis. Okay? So, I'm not working this out in detail, I'm just indicating to you about this course, that this sum over n's, sum over one integer associated with each phase can be decomposed into integers that can be absorbed into the phi field and integers that cannot. The only integers that cannot, as is perhaps intuitive, is the source of flux in each hypercube. Okay? Because we've seen that the source of flux for anything that can be absorbed into some shifted alpha, the shifted phi, is zero. However, the sum over n's does not in general have that that integral over flux equal to zero. Okay? So that part certainly cannot be absorbed. And one can show that's the only part that cannot be absorbed. Okay? Now, this absorbing some integer shift into phi and summing over those integers turns the integral over periodic phi into an integral over each phi from minus infinity. Okay? So the part that can be absorbed in phi actually simplifies it. Because it's easier to do integrals from minus infinity to infinity than from 0 to 2 pi.
So how did this happen?
How did this happen? Basically, what's happening is that when this sum over these fluxes here can be written as a sum over shifts of phi by the integer. Okay? Plus something else, which is basically this plus the source for this sum of integral of flux for each hypercube. Okay? Now the shifts of phi by an integer, that integer You've been doing an integral of phi from 0 to 2 pi. And then we're also doing the sum of the shift by an arbitrary integer. So that sum plus integral just becomes integral over minus infinity to 10. Let me say, suppose we have integral dx, okay, from 0 to 2 pi. Okay, but what we actually have is integral dx plus m and sum over m. This is the same as integral minus infinity to infinity of some dx, right? Is this clear? Okay, these m's do not affect what goes. Yeah, right.
Why can't we
do this
on BKT algorithms? Like, if you could absorb all this stuff into the phi integral, the BKT algorithm should happen, right?
Wait, but we can't absorb everything. Yeah, this is precisely the point. But there's a part of it that you can absorb into the phi integral. Okay, but there's a part that you cannot. It's exactly the analog of what happens. So what is this? So there, once again, you can absorb a part into the phase, but you cannot absorb the part that gives you what is. Okay, here we can't absorb by the monopoles. So let's say, you know, so there, once again, so that maybe we can talk about this later. It's very similar analysis, actually. It's actually very similar.
Okay.
In fact, it's a bit easier. But this analysis was first done by B of BKT in his PhD thesis. Exactly the way that I remember. Because nobody remembered that. Until Kostler. But very, very similar, yes. Okay. So now let's go. You see, so what the end result is that if g is very small, what you get is that this part, you know, these phi's, just we're doing the integral from minus infinity to infinity, plus you have to sum over sources for integrals of f over each possible hypothetical. Okay? So now, the whole f, the whole, you see, and then what, as long as g is small enough, this part, you know, the alphas, can, we've already made this square, so this just becomes like an f mu, minus this extra source kind of f, the whole thing squared. Now, what is the source kind of f, the whole thing squared? The source kind of f, the whole thing squared, is precisely the field strength of a magnetic monopole of every possible integer source located at the center of one of these hypercubes. It's a magnetic monopole because the integral of f around the cube is non-zero. That's what defines a magnetic monopole. Integral f, non-zero. And in fact, the strength of that integral of f is the net integer, the sum over n's. Okay? No, this hypercube is the hypercubes in lattice. In the lattice. So imagine that I'm in three dimensions. I talk about four dimensions. That's a bit easier than so imagine that I'm in three dimensions. Okay? So we've got a lattice that is a union of hypercubes. I shouldn't call it hypercube, it's three dimensions, cube. Okay? It's a union of cubes. So I'm doing one of those cubes.
So one of the black
cubes. It's a cube. It's not a plaquette. A plaquette is a two-dimensional. This cube is what I draw. Do you understand? So, the whole lattice, imagine just a cubic lattice. It's a bunch of cubes. It's called something, right? Unit cells. Okay, so it's a bunch of cubes. It makes up the whole lattice. Okay? So, the net result, and this you will do carefully in a problem set, but the net result is that what we have to do, what we have is a discretized version over doing the integral over all a mu's, which is genuine a mu's. you know, just a new field computer, but also summing over the field strength of magnetic monopoles, of arbitrary integer strength, okay, placed at the center of every hypercube. Okay, now because we take g very small, now we move to continuum notation. Okay, so this integral over this alpha part can just really genuinely be approximated by f, and then you get f square plus the magnetic monopole thing square plus f cross term of the magnetic monopole. Okay.
Sir, is this just like Gauss's law in this one?
Like Gauss's law, but for magnets.
Yeah.
Okay? You see, Gauss's law for magnetism in the genuine continuum framework just gives you that integral f over any closed surface is zero. Because if f is dA and A is a well-defined field, then there's nothing left to say. Integral f over it's just zero.
Yeah.
But you see, the point here was that f being equal to dA was something that emerged out of the weak coupling limit. And it wasn't precisely equal to dA. You see, it was equal to dA plus this integer shift. Okay? And that fact allows us to violate the 9 Gauss's law of magnetism. And in fact, have sources of magnetic field strength. Is this clear? So, now, when you process this whole problem, okay?
Is there any physical way to think how this weak coupling gives rise to magnetic monopoles? Is there a physical description for this? I mean, mathematically, I get it that this shift gives us the magnetic monopoles, but if you try to think what is happening physically,
yeah, but somehow very important is the period. I'm not sure if this is what you want, but let me say one more thing. You see, what was very important with this was that this U1 was period. Okay, that was crucial for everything that I could say. Okay, now, you can ask, and actually everything I'm saying will work whenever the U1 is period. Whether it comes from this lattice or not. Okay? So you can ask, is there some other situation that you're aware of in which you get a periodic U1? Purely in the continuum. Can somebody tell me about a situation? Purely in the continuum where you get naturally a periodic U1? Hint that appears in the standard. When you get the U1 or a spontaneous breaking of a non-abelian symmetry. You see, non-abelian symmetries are by their very nature periodic. Okay, so if you take SU2, there's no option of making any of the U1s inside it non-periodic. It just is periodic. Okay? So if you take it, if you have an SU2 model, for instance, and you spontaneously break SU2 down to U1, okay? Then you will automatically have a periodic one. But you will also automatically then have the monopoles. Why? Because you've got the Toft monopoles. The Toft polyhedron.
So this is like breaking of symmetry essentially.
No, this way. I'm saying that every time you have a periodic U1, you also have monopole type configurations. Okay? In that situation, I'm not sure how much you guys know about monopoles and so on. But anyway, in that situation, what are these magnetic monopoles? They're genuine, smooth solutions of the equations of motion. Where how does Gauss's law get violated? Gauss's law gets violated by the fact that in the core of the monopole, you don't have a U1 theory, you have an SU2 theory. Okay? So, in every case, what happens is that you've got an effective U1 theory at long distances. But at very short distances, there's some new physics that violates your naive analysis of U1. Here, what is the new physics? It's the lattice. There, what is the new physics? it was the asymptote gauge theory. Okay? But every time you got this continuity one, you have in some model that, you know, can make sense all the way to the ultraviolet, you get new phenomena. Okay? Then allow this model. Okay, fine. But let me continue. So how does this proceed? This proceeds in the following way. So what you had was the field strength of the A field. You had the monopole field strength, and then you had the whole thing square. So you got the nine field strength, the cross term, and the monopole field strength. Okay? Now, we can just do the integral over the A mu's, because that's just a Gaussian problem. Okay, what does this do? Well, this generates is some effective interaction between the monopoles. What is the effective interaction with the generator? How will it fold the distance?
So it's like something like a J mu in kind of a thing.
It's sort of like a J-mu. It's not quite J-mu because it's magnetic. But otherwise,
yeah.
It's J-dual. Okay, so good. So that's good. So what interaction will it generate? One over R, right? It will just be Coulomb's law. It's the duality between electric field and magnetic field. So just like if you had sources of electric charge interacting with Maxwell field, and you integrate out the Maxwell field, that generates a 1 over R potential between these sources of electric field. A very similar way, the structure of Maxwell field, if you have sources of magnetic field, you generate out the electric. You generate a 1 over R potential. Okay? So what this problem becomes, because now you can just do the integral, the part that the integral over the continuum gauge fields, that's sort of trivial. Okay? You can just do that integral. And what this becomes is an effective problem for interactions of the monopoles. So what you have to do is to sum over all possible monopole strengths. So you've got a gas of monopoles. This is like your gas of vortices for the beginning transition. Okay? Where there would be some sort of logarithmic interaction in that case. That's replaced here by one of the interaction. Okay, so you get a gas of monopoles. The monopole number is not conserved. It could be anything. Because at each point you could have monopole with strength minus one, minus infinity to infinity. Okay? And these guys interact with each other. Now, the following is true. Okay? It turns out that, firstly, this gas of monopoles, of course, costs energy. Okay? Because you've got the 1 over R potential, but you've also got the core energy of each monopole, which is basically just this n squared by g squared. Okay? So you've got a core energy for each monopole. So you've got these monopoles being produced. G is very small, so they're produced very dilute. So only a very dilute gas of monopoles that's produced. Okay, but there's this really interesting fact. The interesting fact is that even if this monopole gas is produced very dilutely, if you've got an infinite space, there is some density of this monopole gas. That density will go like e to the power minus 1 by g squared. But there's some density. So if you computed correlation functions in this problem at very large distances, at extremely large distances, g is very small, but L is, and you go to very large distances compared to e to the power minus 1 by g squared, these monopoles will affect your correlators. And it turns out that what it does is affect your correlators in a way to give the photon a mass. A very small mass. Mass of order e to the power minus 1 by g squared. Okay? So, that this theory does not actually have massless particles. Okay? In a similar way, you can actually show, as I said, I will formulate a problem that will help you step by step to show these things. No, this will be one of your problems. Okay? In a similar way, you can show that the Wilson loop, even in this weak coupling instance, has an area with a very small coefficient. The coefficient being e to the power minus 1 inches. Okay? So we conclude the following. And by the way, this is in three dimensions again. Everything I said is true in three dimensions. So we conclude the following. From this analysis, we conclude that the theory at strong coupling, an area law for the Wilson loop, and also has a mass gap. Okay, the mass gap is just the fact that when you compute the free energy, it's dominated by the vacuum plus some small stuff with some small surfaces. But the vacuum dominates it. Okay? That was not a surprise. But there was a lot of room in the problem for there to have been a phase transition as you went from strong coupling to weak coupling. Strong coupling is some lattice artifact. It has nothing to do with the real problem we're trying to study. The real problem we're trying to study is trace S squared. And that only emerges at weak coupling because it forces this cosine to be near this one. But the point we've seen is the following. It's a very beautiful point. The point we've seen is the following. That the point we've seen here is that even at weak coupling, this particular lattice model displays a mass gap and displays an area law of Wilson. Okay? This happens even at weak coupling. It happens very weakly. Okay, the area law and the mass gap both scale like e to the power minus 1 by g squared. Very small mass.
What do you mean for the area law?
Area law. This is the thing that we talked about last time, that the expectation value of the Wilson loop, yeah, when the Wilson loop is made very large,
yes,
scales like the area of the scope. Okay. This, by the way, is an order parameter for confinement. It's the statement that if you put a classical charge and an anti-charge, the cost for energy for separating them over distance L scales like L. Is this clear? So, this little lattice model in three dimensions, okay? This little lattice model in three dimensions, okay? This is the lattice model in three dimensions. Both in weak coupling and strong coupling displays a mass gap and area law for the Wilson. So there is no reason to believe that the model undergoes a phase transition at any value of the coupling. Okay? And there appears always to display confining time. Solitonic configurations of four dimensions are instantons for the three dimensional theory. Okay, this is just for the people who know what this means. In the lectures that follow this course and the next one, in the next semester, I will explain all these things in much more detail. Okay, but the solitaire electronic configurations, which are instantons with three dimensions, they have to be summed over. And doing that summation over instantons produces the mass gap and produces the area law. Okay? Even in this continuum theory. Okay? So, in three dimensions, therefore, we find that periodic U1 theories where the gauge group is periodic, typically appear to confine even in the continuum. And the thing that is responsible for the confinement is instantons. Or these magnetic monopole type configurations. Proliferation of magnetic monopole type configurations, okay, lead to mass gap confinement. The analogous statement, since you brought it up, for the Berezinski Costellus-Thouless transition, is that when you've got a periodic U1, if you allow, you know, configurations with vortices, there it's a little more subtle, because there's a coupling constant in the theory. Okay? And after a critical value of the coupling constant, these vortices proliferate. And once the vortices proliferate, you know, before that critical value is reached, in that situation, you don't have a finite density of vortices. Can somebody remind me why? Do you know the model I'm talking about? Shall we have a 5-10 minute diversion in studying that model? We could do that. Yes. Let's try that. Okay. Last time I tried spontaneous diversion, I got myself into trouble. Probably the same mistake. Let's try. Okay. Okay, the BKT model is simply a model of spins. Okay, so in that case, let's say we're in 2 dimensions, and in that case, what we have is we want to model this SI dot ST right kind of interaction. So the model is 1 by G squared, you know, 1 minus cosine of phi I minus phi j. Phi I minus phi I plus ni I plus n a sum over all a sum over all I. We've got a 2-dimensional lattice. Our phi's live on the sides. Okay? And what we have is that there's an interaction associated with every link. The variables are on sides, but you've got this phi minus this phi, cosine of that, 1 minus that, the whole thing squared, and you've got the sum of this way as well as that way. Okay?
So in our case, phi
lives
on the
links. What? In our case, phi lives on links. So this is a completely separate problem. Let's call these S's. This is a spin. Okay, it's the matter fields, not gauge fields. These matter fields live on sides. Okay, this is a model that if you take the naive continuum limit, like we did, we'll replace this by Si minus Si plus delta the whole thing squared, which is simply the derivative. Simply the derivative of the S field. So the naive continuum description of this model. Okay, the naive continuum description of this model is delta S the whole thing squared. That of a free scale of it. Okay? So in the weak coupling limit, this model looks like it's just going to become the free scale of it. Okay? But it's very important that we're going to treat in this model that S is periodic. So S is the same as S plus 2 prime. Okay? So what it really becomes is like the continuum description of free scalar field with periodic S. Now, free scalar field with periodic S
But misconfigurations of the free scalar field with unperiodic S does not impact it. These are winding configurations. Configurations so that you start somewhere and you go around a circle and you come back, and S has not come back to itself but has come back after a winding of 2 pi or 2 pi or 4 pi or something. Okay? Such configurations are called vortices. Okay? And this continuum model has these vortices. This discrete model has these vortices very similarly described. This cosine should not be approximated by the difference square. Should be approximated by difference square minus integer. Okay? We've got an integer associated with each leg. So the integer is a vector field. Then we use the analog of the discrete analog of the theorem that every vector field can be written as a gradient plus a curl. Okay, in two dimensions, any vector field AI can be written as del I of phi plus epsilon ij and j of kappa. As a continuum statement, this is true and obvious. Okay, and there is a discrete analog of the statement that you can easily manufacture. Now, the set of integers that is in this del I of is just the difference between an integer here and an integer here, and that is just absorbed into shifting S. Okay? So the integral over periodic S plus the sum of these integers just changes the integral over S to be integral from minus infinity. However, there remain these integers. Okay? What is the property of this thing? The property of this thing is that it will allow for winding of this effective phi. Okay? So these chi's here are effective vorticity anchors. Okay? Very much like the integers that we couldn't absorb into the shift of the phi's in our gauge model, give us effective monopotentials. Okay? Now, this model does become del phi plus the effective phi for a vortex. So, phi vortex plus del phi vortex, the whole thing square. And once again, exactly like in our problem, this part is just integrating, it's a Gaussian integral, can be integrated out. Generates an interaction between the vortices. Okay? What is the interaction strength for a vortex? It's just 1 over del square in 2 dimensions. Just like 1 over r was 1 over del square in 3 dimensions. Okay? And simply gives you a log of potential between 2 vortices. So you get a Coulomb gas, an effective Coulomb gas, but in 2 dimensions. Now this is the point. The point was that let's ask, can you generate a single vortex? Okay? And this we can estimate by energy versus entropy. A single vortex has infinite energy. Not because of the core, because that's regulated by the lattice, but because of what happens at infinity. Because of the log. The energy of a single vortex is of order 1 over g squared, okay, times some log of r is the size of the system. But how many places are there to put a single vortex? How many places can a single vortex be in? Number of plaquettes, which is r squared. Okay, so what is the entropy for a single vortex? It's log of r squared. Okay, so the energy associated with having such a vortex is this. If we are at finite temperature, the free energy associated with having such a vortex is this is the energy, and then there's a minus T times log of. because
F is U minus TS.
F is U minus TS. This is U. This is TS. You understand this log R comes from the log of R squared. I mean, ignore it back to something. Okay? Now you see that there is a critical value of G of order 1 at which this becomes negative. Until that happens, you do not produce single vortices. You can produce vortex-anti-vortex pairs. But vortex-anti-vortex pairs do not produce the mass gap. Why do you produce a mass gap? You produce a mass gap because it's a bit uncomfortable to say all these things without proving. Anyway, but let me just say it. Yeah. You see, what does a vortex or a monopole feel? It takes the vacuum and randomizes it a bit. That is, you know, when you not have a mass gap, you don't have a mass gap in a theory when correlation functions fall off at infinity very slowly. Like a powder. Sorry, when do you have mass? When you not have mass. When you have massless particles, when correlation functions fall off at infinity very slowly, like a powder. Okay? In this situation, what happens? When you've got a whole lot of vortices randomly sprinkled all over the place, because of the randomness in this, what's happening here becomes effectively uncorrelated with what's happening there. Okay? That causes exponential decay. But if you've got a vortex anti-vortex pair, as far as far away is concerned, it's like having nothing. So vortex anti-vortex pairs that are bound to each other don't cause this randomization of the phase. Don't produce more. The kind of thing that will produce the mass gap is a gas of single vortices. And we've seen that in this problem, that happens, but only if you put it at finite temperature. And only at high enough temperature, when the entropy beats the energy.
So, anti-vortex is something in which the curl is the other way.
Okay. On the other hand, in our problem, it was very important that the potential didn't go like log, but went like 1 over r. 1 over r is finite infinity. Okay? So the energy of a single monopole was finite. And therefore, monopole gas is produced. And once a monopole gas is produced, the randomization of stuff happens, and the mass gap is all but inevitable. So, I'm sorry, this has been very qualitative. It's been very qualitative. But it was meant mainly to be an introduction, to give you the ideas, and you're going to work this out in detail in your homework. Okay? Any questions or comments about this at in D equals 3 before we turn to D equals 4?
How the integral from 0 to 2 pi on summing over n became an integral from.
Yeah. You see, what we have. Let me stay in this context, but it's a bit easier to say. Okay? We've got these integers associated with links. Okay? So we've got an nij for each link. Now, we use the fact that any nij can be written as ni minus nj. Plus, something else that characterizes the vorticity. Okay, let me ignore the something else because that's not important. Okay, so if your nij was just mi minus nj, what happened to this thing? We use the periodic approximation for the cosine. So this cosine is replaced by sum over si minus si plus na. Okay. Plus mi minus mi plus na. To the extent that nij is mi minus nj, this is true. And what we are doing is the integral e to the power minus 1 by g squared ds, right? But we are also summing over all ni's. Now you see that the summation over n, now define a new variable, which is si plus n. the integral over s from 0 to 2 pi plus the summation over n is effectively an integral from minus infinity to infinity of this new variable s prime. Is this clear? That's what happens also in the gate. Okay. Any other questions or comments?
What we saw in the 3D model is that
what?
The thing that we saw in the 3D model is that there is no deconfined phase at all. Or
that there is no deconfined phase at all. That's right.
It's not very clear to me why exactly is that. I mean, the model that we studied showed this particular property, but is it mimicking nature correctly? I don't know.
Well, like I tried to say, if there is some other way of producing a compact U1 theory. One easy purely continuum way of producing a compact U1 theory. Okay, what was the A1? What was the compactness? Okay, if you just take the continuum U1 theory by itself, it's a free model. Okay, and certainly does not confine. Let's just del mu A mu the whole thing square, that does not confine. But we want to put in the compactness somehow. Okay, that the U1 was compact. So, suppose we now look at the model, which is SU2 spontaneously broken to U1. And we can take the scale of the spontaneous breaking to be very high. But find it. Okay? Then, how does the path integral over U1s? How does the path integral over the U1 gauge field differ from integral twice s squared? It differs from it in the fact that we have to, in the full model, include instant terms. That is, there is some region, when you go to very small distances, okay, you see that the theory is no longer U1. Now, this happens over very small distances, doesn't really matter very much, they're highly suppressed processes. But the important point is that produces these monopoles, that these monopole configurations exist. That monopole configurations exist and with some finite action, no matter how long. Once that's the case, okay, this deconfinement is basically inevitable. The confinement is essentially inevitable. Because the path integral includes the sum over all these monopoles, that randomizes. That is the basic physics of the theory. So if you're dealing with any U1 theory in which monopole configurations exist, okay, then in three dimensions, confinement is basically inevitable. Monopole configurations exist and contribute with finite action, no matter how large. Okay, then confinement is essentially inevitable. That was the essence of our lesson of our. Is this clear? Okay. Now, suppose you redid this whole analysis in four dimensions. Okay? Suppose you redid this whole analysis in four dimensions. Okay? Then what would you get? You have these, in any three-dimensional cube, you get these monopole-like plaquettes. But perhaps you would not be too surprised to hear that these monopoles turn into particles. That you've got these magnetic monopoles because you've got actually four dimensions. So there's a world line for these monopoles. Okay? So now what you get is that when you redo the whole analysis, you get these monopole world lines, you have to do the integral over all these monopole world lines. Okay? You've got to do the integral over all these monopole world lines. Interacting with the potential that you get by integrating by basically a 1 over del square potential in four dimensions.
So these monopole world lines are contained inside the cube in which they are in
order. No. So now we've got you see, in every three-dimensional cube, we get a monopole, but that monopole extends that in time. Okay? So the monopole world line lives in a sequence of hypercubes.
So it's like a tube kind of
thing. It's like a line. Yeah, right, like a tube. Okay? Now, these monopole world lines that you sum over are closed surfaces. Okay? And so their effect on long distance correlators, just like the vortex antivortex pair, is not large unless monopoles of world lines like this, you know, infinite long world lines, unless infinite long world lines condense in the vacuum. Okay? And when you analyze this problem, it turns out to be similar to the BKT transition in the sense that this question, whether this happens or not, depends on the coupling of the profile. Okay? A very strong coupling, these monopoles do condense. That gives rise to confinement, an area law for the Wilson loop, as we've already seen from the strong coupling expansion, which was dimensioned anyway. But there is a finite coupling at which this condensation of monopoles stops. After that coupling, when the coupling becomes small enough, these long world lines do not exist in the theory. You just have these small little loops. And it's like the other phase of the BKT transition. And you recover a massless gauge boson. Okay? So, in four dimensions, this lattice model has very different phenomenology. In four dimensions, this lattice model has very different phenomenology. Okay? It describes a problem, and now you can see this very clearly. You see, it describes a problem of particles interacting by some sort of potential. Okay? Now, you can imagine that writing down a field theory for these particles. So it's a field theory of these monopoles interacting with some sort of potential. And here clearly you've got a choice, right? If you've got a field theory of some monopoles, either the field condenses or it doesn't. The condensation of that field leads to the confined phase. That's the phase in which these long world lines of these monopoles proliferate.
So what do you mean by condensation as a monopole and the two monopoles are combining together?
No. So the condensation in terms of a field is exactly what like the Higgs field. Okay, just phi has non-zero expectation. Okay, so there is a macroscopic number of monopoles in the vacuum. I mean exactly that the classical field has an expectation. Okay, so in that lattice model what happens? In that lattice model what happens is that as you tune the coupling from strong to weak, there is a phase transition itself. For weaker couplings, you get a theory which has no proliferation of these monopole world lines. And you get, at in the extreme weak coupling limit, you recover pure, free F square theory.
So, when you say that monopoles condense, we know that vacuum consists of monoparticles. So, do you mean that vacuum consists of these monopoles?
I mean that the scalar field described. For the monopoles, has a non-zero expectation value. Okay? Now that statement is a bit...
So why condensation is used for this? What is condensing?
What is condensing? It's like this, right? This phi obtains a expectation value. Okay. Now, it's a bit tricky. You have to be a bit careful about what this means. Because, for instance, it is not true that there is charge in the vacuum. Suppose you have a scalar field that condenses. What's the charge operator? The charge operator is phi star phi dot minus phi dot phi star dot phi. Since the condensator has no dot, both terms of this charge operator are zero. Okay? So this condensation is not like it prefers monopoles over anti-monopoles. It's not like there's a net charge But in some classical configuration, which is as many monopoles as anti-monopoles, but these just proliferate all over the vacuum. It's the same condensation as used in the Higgs phenomenon. Okay, the same word is used there. It's the same phenomenon. Okay, so in the abelian problem, okay, in three dimensions and four dimensions for this lattice problem, we know what happens. Okay, the summary was that the abelian problem in three dimensions, okay, that the abelian problem in three dimensions, that the abelian problem in three dimensions has confinement and a mass gap for every finite value of the coupling, whether weak or strong. The abelian problem in four dimensions has confinement and a mass gap, a sufficiently strong coupling, but no confinement, no gap, mass gap for weak coupling, and a phase transition in the middle, and that phase transition is associated with monopole condensation. It's like Higgs phenomenon for the monopole field. Okay? Now, what about the non-abelian theories? Okay? For the non-abelian theory, I'm not even sure if my knowledge about this is up to date. But in the papers I had looked up and I studied the subject, which were 20-30 years ago. Maybe somebody knows more about this now. I haven't carefully searched. No? But in the non-abelian theory, it was strongly expected that in three dimensions, okay, everything that was said for the abelian theory would be true also of the non-abelian theory. At some stage, the situation was, there was no proof of the statement, but it seemed very, very likely to be true. Okay? You have to do more. This whole story about that. Okay? So, the expectation, the strong expectation, perhaps by now there's a proof, because it was such an intuitive expectation. You know, roughly the idea is that if you've got configurations, a subclass of configurations that disorder the vacuum. You see, if you've got an SU2 theory, then U1 configurations are a subclass of such configurations. So you definitely have the U1 instantons, these U1 magnetic monopoles. So that sort of disorders the vacuum. Now you may have more, but it sounds like it should disorder the vacuum. That was roughly the idea. Okay? So, in three dimensions, the non-abelian theory was strongly expected to behave, and by now I'm pretty sure somebody must have proved this, I just don't know what. Okay. Was strongly expected to behave like the abelian theory. That is, the non-abelian theory strongly expected, and perhaps proved, to display confinement in any law of physics at every value of the coupling, not just in the strong coupling dimension. So the next lesson is that in three dimensions, the strong expectation is that no phase transitions. What you see in the strong coupling expansion is a good qualitative guide to physics. And all is finite values of the coupling, whether strong or weak. Okay? But now, in four dimensions, we have seen that the abelian theory at strong coupling behaves exactly like the non-abelian theory. You know, displays the area law, displays confinement, as we saw in the last class. Okay? But we've also seen that the abelian theory has a phase transition at finite values of the model. And so by the time you actually get to the field theory, it displays completely different behavior. Displays free behavior, no mass gap, no confinement. Now the expectation is that it's different for the non-abelian theory. That the abelian and the non-abelian theory behave differently. That is, that the non-abelian theories continue, that the strong coupling expansion is a good guide, good qualitative guide for the behavior of non-abelian theories at every value of the lattice coupling. Okay? Now, of course, there is a huge amount of practical evidence for this statement, which is a success of the lattice cage theory program. So the huge number of lattice simulations performed in lattice cage theory all over the world using this action, when they take it to weak coupling, they see effectively confinement. There's of course very strong evidence for the correctness of this conjecture. But there is nothing like analytic understanding of this. See, the kind of thing that people like. Hello? Hello? The kind of thing that would be satisfactory is an identification of the mechanism for producing the mascot. In three dimensions, we have this mechanism. It's these monopoles. This gas of monopoles, the proliferation of the monopoles, produces the mascot. Okay? And we see that this happens with a certain inevitability. As long as these monopole configurations exist, it randomizes these things. These monopole configurations have IR finite energy, so that produces the mascot. Okay. There's a certain inevitability about the whole thing. Okay? What is the mechanism in four dimensions? Well, the abelian theory suggests it. You see, what happens is that there is condensation of these monopoles. In the abelian theory, this condensation stops at a finite value of the coupling. Okay? So the proposal first made by Toft is that what happens in the non-abelian theory in some way of looking at the problem, part of the difficulty of making this precise is finding exactly what that way of looking at the problem is. But Toft worked in this maximal abelian gauge. I can tell you about that, but maybe later. Then some way of looking at the problem, there is also condensation of monopoles in the non-abelian theory, but that this condensation persists all the way down to very weak coupling. That is a conjecture, and proving it is one of these clay prizes of, proving it will win you $1 million. It's one of these clay foundation prizes. For a while it used to be touted as an outstanding problem of theoretical physics. Proof confinement of non-abelian statics. Of course, you know, it's often the case with such things that not so clear to me, at least, that it is is one of these great problems of theoretical physics. Because it may just be an issue of detail. That is, if it's true, and there's a lot of evidence of this, that's happening by monopole condensation, it could be that if you change the parameters of the problem in some way, maybe we'll discuss this. So it could be that the proof does not teach you very much at the end. Once you have it. You know, the proof that teaches you stuff is something with elegance or something that identifies a new physical mechanism. If you already know the physical mechanism, somehow just can't argue that the parameters are such that it confines, I'm not sure we will learn that much. Okay, so this was meant to be a very brief bird's eye summary of the behavior of these lattice models that define lattice gauge theories as a function of coupling. The summary was that at strong coupling, all of them display confinement and mask. Weak coupling is what relates to actual quantity of things. The important question is there a phase transition as you go from strong coupling to weak coupling? In three dimensions, strongly believe that both in non-abelian as well as the abelian theory, there is no such. And for the abelian theories, we will have problems. In the problem sets, where you will prove this. Okay? In the in four dimensions, we more or less know for sure, because we can work out the strong coupling and weak coupling expansions, that there is a phase transition. The strong coupling and weak coupling expansions behave differently. Okay. In non-abelian theory, we've never been able to work out the weak coupling expansion properly. So we do not know for sure whether or not the non-abelian theory confines, but there's strong numerical evidence that it does. Okay. So there is no phase transition in these lattice models from strong to weak coupling in four dimensions. Okay, I'm sorry for the very qualitative nature of this lecture. There have been almost no equations. But, you know, to do this, so I'm just assigning this the one part of it that will become quantitative, I'll put it in the problems. Part of the reason for this is qualitative is that I just didn't want to spend the time for the 2-3 lectures. The 2-3 lectures that it would take. The other part that is qualitative is that some of it is just not very well understood. Like, at least when I last looked at it, when I last seriously looked at this, the non-abelian theory in 3 dimensions was not that well understood. And certainly the non-abelian theory in 4 dimensions is not very well understood. Okay. Partly it's my inadequacy, partly it's the inadequacy of the field that I've left these lectures qualitative. But just to give you a bird's eye overview of this. Any questions or comments before we proceed?
But this is not directly related to this, but you mentioned the problem that non-abelian gauge theories are naturally periodic.
How do we see that? Well, let's look at the gauge group SU2 for instance. Okay? The gauge group of SU2 is a 3-sphere. Okay? Oh, maybe even more. Okay. So, SU2 can be thought of as unitary transformation, two cross two unitary matrices. Every 2x2 unitary matrix can be written as e to the power I, alpha I, sigma I, where sigma I is one of the matrices.
So we can write them as cos theta.
Now, let us take the U1 subgroup that comes with that sigma I just being sigma 3. Okay, so it's e to the power I, alpha I, sigma 3. Now let us remember that sigma 3, maybe we want sigma 3 by 2. That depends on the alpha. Okay, now let us remember that the eigenvalues of sigma 3 are plus or minus 1. Therefore, if alpha I goes to alpha I by 4 pi, this matrix goes back to 0. Therefore, the parameter of this gauge transformation is automatically mutated. It's that simple. That if you take a U1 subgroup within the space of unitary matrices, it's always periodic. Another way of thinking is the group manifold itself is compact. So how are you going to produce a U1 that goes off to infinity?
And
U1
is more naturally just because we have e to the power I theta. Now,
when you have e to, you see, the point is that the U1 composition rule is x and y, such that x, when you compose, x just goes to x plus y. This is the rule for the tangents. That composition rule is consistent whether x and y live on an infinite space or on a circle. Okay? So group theory doesn't force you to make it periodic. Okay? Some physics might. Okay, but here group theory forces you to make this. I mean, just it's just a fact, a mathematical fact of the world, of the logic, that unitary groups, all the U1 subgroups of unitary groups are compact. Clear? Okay. I will have my last 10-15 minutes before getting back to the continuum. Last 10-15 minutes since we started this. There's one really nice piece of work with these lattice gauge theories by Polyakov and Sassi on the deconfinement transition for these field theories as a function of temperature in the stratotopic expansion, which I wanted to show you. Just because it's so nice and it introduces a new piece of physics in a controllable setting, though it's far from the continuum theory.
So it's a little more. The four-dimensional version of these Young-Weil series, the supersymmetric version of the four-dimensional Young-Weil series, is well understood. In the strong coupling limit, is well understood in terms of gravity. The four-dimensional, the supersymmetric version of the four-dimensional Young-Weil theory,
yes,
in the strong coupling limit, is well understood in terms of gravity.
Yes.
The weak coupling is not, or doesn't have such an analogous understanding.
No.
If one could develop an understanding from the gravity, is it at all possible to develop an understanding from the gravity
side? I'm going to attempt. But please go on. What do you want? Where are you going?
No, I'm just trying to ask a very simple question. So why, whether at all it would be, one would be able to understand a weak upper from the gravity center.
And now, to get a sense before I answer, is this question concerned with confinement or not? So it's a very important fact that the supersymmetric version of the problem that is well understood is a conformality theory for every value of the gravity. That you can prove with or without gravity. Okay? And conformal field theories cannot have a mass gap. Okay? Because the mass gap, the size of the mass gap would be a scale. There's no scale.
Yeah.
Okay? So there never was a confinement issue. Okay. Now, it's true that the maximally supersymmetric n equals y angles theory is understood completely through gravity. Could we imagine a gravitational description of weakly coupled n equals y angles? Answer is, by gravity you mean really Einstein gravity, not string theory. Answer is no. Okay. You can see this in a zillion ways, but the easiest way to see this. You see, a theory of gravity has the feature that it has particles of spin 2, and that's it. Okay? So, if you take a theory of gravity, there's something distinguished about particles of spin 2. Okay? On the other hand, okay, let me answer this question for confining, let's say QCD. Let me answer the question why QCD could not possibly be. On the other hand, QCD has glue ball states. Large n QCD has glue ball states of all spin. And the spin 3 glue balls are not parametrically higher in energy than the spin 2 glue balls. Already that makes it clear that it's impossible that gravity gives you a dual description of QCD. Because at least in the templates that we have, the glue balls of QCD are simply graviton wave function, graviton excitations. And just the fact that gravity stops at spin 2 makes it clear that a qualitative feature of the actual spectrum of QCD is not being reproduced. Okay? However, string theory has particles of all spin. And almost certainly does give you a dual description of QCD as well as it was working. We complete. Okay? But really, the issue is not whether it gives you a description, whether it's a useful description. For that, you need to know the description. You see, any SCFT is great, not just because of the conceptual thing, but because one side of the correspondence, you can actually do calculations. Unless that happens, it's not useful. Okay, other questions, comments? Okay, so I'm going to now introduce for you the Hamiltonian version of lattice cage theory. What do I mean by that? So far what we've been doing is taking the path integral of lattice cage theory, okay, and making all bonds, discretizing both space and time. Now what I'm going to do is the following. I'm going to do something asymmetric. Break the symmetry between space and time. So I will keep time as a continuum direction, but discretize only space. Okay? So I'm going to keep time as a continuum direction, but discretize only space. Okay. How do I now? What do I do? So in the spatial direction. So there is. Let's do the UI problem. Okay, so we wanted to generate f mu nu f mu. Now there are two kinds of f mu nu's. There's fij and there's f0i. Okay? In order to generate fij, I do exactly what I did before. Okay? I get 1 over g squared times 1 minus cosine of the stuff we have there. Like this minus this plus this minus this, the whole thing square. Right? This is, as far as we're concerned, as far as the logical structure of the problem is concerned, the potential of the problem. Okay? But the other part, okay? going to be continued. So, you know, we also had in the lattice description, we also had A0, some sort of phi field. We also had some sort of phi field here, living on the time breaks. Okay. Now there are no time breaks. This is going to be a scalar field at each lattice set. Time is continuous. And we just write down f0i the whole thing squared. Now what is f0i the whole thing squared? f0i is del I a0 minus del 0 ai. Let's call it del 0 ai minus del I a0. It's f0i. Okay, del 0 ai will just be discretized by each of these. There was a link variable here. We'll just get the time derivative of that. Okay, so suppose I have a link variable away from the I to the jth guy, or phi I, however it is. So there will be a dot here. But remember, there is also now a new scalar field on each side, which was A0. The new scalar field, let's call it chi I. So do you see that F0i, the whole thing squared, is simply this object here. Is this clear?
Sir, why did you get chi I is del I A0, right?
No, chi i is A0 at psi. What?
So f0i is del i a0.
And that's why I got a minus and a plus. This difference gives me a del i a0.
Okay.
And this thing was just del 0 of a i. Okay. So, now I'm going to write down the final model. Okay. That the Lagrangian is equal to what? So, we write out the final model and then get factors of the lattice coupling correct by taking the continuum, by taking the time continuum. Okay, so first I'll write it out without factors of the lattice coupling. So the Lagrangian is phi I, and it's always difficult to write this notation, so I plus nj, I plus nj dot plus, okay, so this is del 0 AI minus del I A0. So minus phi chi I plus chi I plus NG. Whole thing squared minus. Yeah, it's minus this thing here gives us the correct continuous description. Now remember that phi was to be associated with a times this little thing. Sorry. Hello. Hi, Vivek. Vivek, I'm in the middle of a lecture now. Could I call you back in maybe half an hour? Okay, yeah. Thanks. Okay. Okay, yeah. Fine. So, if we plug this in here, what does this guy become? This guy becomes approximately, this guy becomes a. This guy becomes a to the 4 x squared, because the derivative requires a 1 by a. So there was an a with the gauge field, and then we wrote the difference, but to turn it into derivative we need a 1 by a. Okay?
Whereas this guy here becomes AI AI dot squared A squared. So this guy should be identified. This guy should be identified with. But this is correct. This guy is just identified with A zero, because then this is minus Li A zero squared with an overall A squared, because the difference converting into the derivative picks up a factor of A squared. Okay, since we want a uniform factor of A squared outside the whole thing, what we should do is to either, let's say, multiply this guy by A squared. We multiply this object by A squared. Okay, and so that this whole thing now becomes A to the 4 by G squared summation, and then if we want to convert the summation into an integral, summation times A to the power D is integral. So that's A to the 4 minus B integral x squared by G squared. Okay, so if we want the actual Yangmills coupling, we want to parameterize it in terms of the actual Yangmills theory, you know, this object here, G squared by Yangmills, is G squared by A to the power. Okay, but we'll keep this g square here, because g square is the dimensionless quantity. Okay, this action, as I've written it now, is manifestly dimensionless, because manifestly dimensionless if you assign this guy dimension 1. This guy is a phase, so it has no dimension, but has a time derivative. So that's got dimension 1. The a square eats that up. And then you assign this mass dimension 1 because it was A0 at mass dimension 1. This is a manifestly dimensionless action. So this is the action we're going to do. Okay? So this is the asymmetric version of lattice gauge theorem that treats time different from space. Okay? Any questions or comments about this? What?
Is there a physical way of saying that we need to put an A squared to have a time continuum?
This A squared here?
Yeah.
It's just to make it dimensionless.
Yeah.
A squared phi dot squared. That would be one way of saying. You see, this guy is clearly a dimensionless object.
Okay.
Every time the Lagrangian has to have the same dimension, so if you press phi dot squared, you need something of cross dimension. Okay. Fine. So this is the this is the Lagrangian we're going to be dealing. Okay, but this continuum lattice gauge theory is useful not in the Lagrangian but in the Hamiltonian formulation. Okay, so in order to understand this theory, what we're going to do is to move to the Hamiltonian framework. Okay, so what we're going to do actually will closely parallel something we did in the early part of our course, when we wrote down the path integral for Yangmills theory and moved to the Hamiltonian framework to understand what Hilbert spaces was describing. Okay, this in fact is a pretty precise version of what we did in the other part, because everything is really concrete. There's no continuum. It's really, if you put it on a torus, it would actually be completely correct. There's no divergence. Okay, so it's going to be very similar to what we did there, so let's do it very briefly. Suppose we've got some phi ij. Okay? We want to find the canonical momentum of the phi ij. Okay. So this pij is simply the derivative of the Lagrangian with respect to this.
is what, a factor of 2 here. So it's the derivative of the Lagrangian with respect to this. And so that Pij is equal to a squared by j squared. So Pij is equal to a squared by j squared phi ij dot minus chi I. Canonical moment.
Oh.
Okay. Now let's compute the Hamiltonian. So, what's a Hamiltonian? So the Hamiltonian is H is equal to Pij Pij dot. And by the way, of course, the canonical momentum for chi was zero. So we're going to give it a Hilbert space interpretation without trying to, you know, quantize chi. Chi will be a Lagrange multiplier, which exactly like we did the earlier part. Of course. Okay, so we've got Pij phi ij dot minus Lagrangian. Okay, now as we did before, we write this as Pij Pij. So we just invert this. Okay, so we'll write phi ij dot is equal to g squared by g squared bij plus chi I minus chi j. Okay, so we'll write this as g squared by a squared so bij into phi ij a squared by, sorry, g squared by a squared, g squared by a squared, pij plus chi I chi j. Okay? And this part here, okay, so this part combined with this term, as we did before, it just simply flips the sign of this piece. It just gives you a factor of half of this piece. It's this minus this. Okay? So it just is Pij, Pij, g squared by a squared. And we can get rid of it by a rescaling of time and a rescaling of the sky. Okay? So imagine we've done that again. We've rescaled time, so time is now dimensionless, t is t by a. And we've rescaled chi, so chi times a. So we've got rid of this a field. From now on, we'll make contact with physics later on, we'll reinstate. But because I've done this rescaling, I'm just going to get rid of this a squared through the discussion. Okay, we can easily reinstate it by undoing the derivative change. Is this clear? One thing that's really important here now is that in this Lagrangian, in this Hamiltonian, okay, and then of course I forgot this part. There was plus Pij chi I minus chi. This is the Hamiltonian. So there are two things we see. Firstly, we see this fact that I made a big deal of at the beginning of the course. That is, well, this is a very straightforward, simple Hamiltonian system. plus this Lagrange. Doing the integral over chi's generates a constraint. Okay? And we'll examine the nature of that constraint. Moment. Okay? But what was this Lagrange? What was this Lagrangian? This Lagrangian is just some pretty simple, you know, it's like a Lagrangian of some spins. There's some kinetic term here, and there's a potential term. The one thing that we see immediately is that the strong coupling limit for this module is extremely simple. Because the strong coupling limit g goes to infinity. So the Lagrangian formulation, the strong coupling limit, the leading term is just 1. Now it's no longer the case. The leading term is this object. This doesn't go away, but this is right. So what does the strong coupling theory do? In the strong coupling limit, in the limit g goes to infinity, the strong coupling limit of this Hamiltonian lattice gauge theory, it makes it a free theory. Remove the potential. Okay? This was electric field, this was magnetic field. You throw away the contribution of the magnetic field. Okay? And it becomes just a free theory. Modulo the constraint.
Also, you were saying this is the free theory because magnetic field used to have the additional momentum of strong which used to form this interaction, or?
It's just that this looks like a nonlinear piece. That is potential. See, in any quantum mechanics, you have kinetic terms and potential terms.
But when you expand it, you will again get some alpha square kind of terms.
What?
When you expand cos, you will again get some
alpha square kind of terms. Yeah, alpha square is 1 over 1 over g square. So in the limit g goes to infinity, all those terms can be ignored. So the strong coupling limit of this model is an extremely simple model. Okay? Let's say, suppose we wrote down the Schrodinger equation now for this problem. What is the Schrodinger equation? The Schrodinger equation has, is a wave function, is an equation for a wave function whose variables are phi i j. These linear variables. Okay? Pij, by the ordinary rules of quantum mechanics, is I del by del phi i j. So this just gives you del squared phi i j. We know the solutions, right? We know the solutions for del squared. The plane waves. Phi, however, are angular variables. So they're plane waves with quantized p's. Okay? So if we ignore this constraint for a moment, the Hilbert space of our problem is extremely simple. Okay? The Hilbert space of our problem is given by e to the power I 2 pi nij phi ij. Okay, product over such things. Where you choose a separate nij for each link.
So, but pij also consists of this chi's, so it's not entirely phi.
No. It's the canonical momentum conjugate to phi. According to the rules of quantum mechanics, the canonical momentum conjugate to a variable is implemented by the operator. Del by del, that operator. Doesn't matter whether it's phi or not. Right? Well, it's Dirac's correspondence principle. The object whose Poisson bracket with your variable is 1 becomes the object whose operator is I d by d. That. No matter what it was. You see, now we've gone to the Hamiltonian framework. We don't even know what p was in terms of phi. That's not our business. Is this clear? Okay, so this product over all I for some choice of nij's gives you the basis set of wave functions for this space. Okay, so we can work in this basis. We can work in the basis of nij's, the momentum basis. Okay, so in the basis of nij's, what's the Hamiltonian? It's just nij squared, g squared
like. Sir, this is just like the BKT model, right? Because when we took the continuum limit of the BKT model, we got an very similar dimension,
sort of, but you know, that we got that by taking the cosine and approximating it by its quadratic base. Here we just throw away the cosine. Yeah, it's sort of like that. I mean,
For the weak end models, we get this plane wave solutions as the basis.
In an appropriate limit, presumably yes. Yeah, right. I think the answer is yes. In strong argument. Okay. Now, the only question here is what does this constraint do? Okay. What the constraint does. Well, what we have to do is just do the integral over all chi i's. That gives you some delta function. Can you see that that tells you, remember chi's live at points. What this tells you is that the sum over, see, what are these nij's by the way? These are electric fluxes that live on links. Because nij's are the eigenvalues of F0i. Momentum conjugate to phi ij was just F0i. Okay? So these nij's are the quantized values of electric fluxes that live on links. Okay? And these phi. Okay, so what we get here is that the sum of all nij's n at a particular point must vanish. You just have to keep track of the signs. The signs are such that if you draw all the fluxes inwards to the same point, rather than summing and sum out, the sum of all electric fluxes ending in the same point must vanish. This is a continuum version of a discrete version of what famous continuum equation? Because del dot E is equal to 0. Okay? So, the Hilbert space is this, subject to the constraint, that sum over ni's, in the sum over the n's ending on any given point is 0. Okay. So this is very simple. This is a very simple, very beautiful, simple, beautiful theory. Now you might, of course, it's struck up lift. Okay. But, so it's very far from the catchy principle. Right? It's far from turning this into AI dot squared. It's really allowing this to fluctuate over everything. It's very far from the actual continuum model. But anyway, let's take the simple continuum model and ask, sorry, simple lattice model, and ask, is there an interesting calculation? There is an interesting calculation. And the interesting calculation is to compute its thermal free energy as a function of temperature. Okay? So what we have to do, what are we trying to do? What we're trying to do is to compute of e to the power minus beta h over this theorem. Okay? Now this h we understand very well.
You got it on the board.
We understand the Hilbert space very well. Okay? Had it not been for the constraint, this would simply have been sum over nij product over j e to the power minus beta nij squared g squared by 2. Okay, it would have been some relatively, okay, very complete function. But there is a constraint. And the constraint is, okay, and the constraint is that this implemented by this. So that we've got e chi I. Okay? E to the power I V I J chi I and chi J. That implements the energy. That implements the constraint. That implements the constraint that the sum of fluxes coming to any site is 0. Thank you. I'll stop in 5 minutes, okay?
The sum over energy.
No, it's just this. This look, I'm just rewriting Lagrangian pattern.
Yes.
Okay. Rewriting. The physical constraint was that the sum over energy is going to a point to zero, as we saw.
So this sum is ensured.
Doing the integral over chi is forces that. This is clear. This is clear, right? Okay. Now, this is the mathematical expression for our, this is the mathematical expression for a partition function. Okay? This is a mathematical expression for a partition function. But, this mathematical expression involves the sum over all integers. Now, whenever you've got a problem in physics, where you've got a sum over, some particular function, summed over all integer values of that function, it is often useful to use Poisson resolution. Okay, to reconvert, to look at the sum of integers in terms of a sum over another set of integers. So let me just remind you of the statement of Poisson.
This Hamiltonian actually is a free Hamiltonian with a certain
with a constraint.
But maybe this is a stupid question, but in a large coupling limit, can we not somehow do with the second term because there's a coefficient g square sitting in the first term?
No, but you see, this constraint sums the allowed values of energies. Constrains the allowed values of energies. Do you see?
Yeah.
You see, we could do with just remove that constraint if you only summed over those NIJs, which are but you see that affects it on a leading order, right? Because configurations which the NIJs don't satisfy that would have contributed at the same order as those that do. So this is the leading order thing. Okay? Right. Okay. So now, let me remind you of the statement of Poisson recently. The statement is that suppose you've got f of x plus, so you've got some function f of x. The summation over f of n is equal to the summation over f tilde of n. When f tilde is a Fourier transform of f, once you define the Fourier transform of the right factors of it, it's got some impersonal, some kind of purpose. It's a simple thing. Okay? Now, we're going to apply that this result to this quantity. When we identify, so let's, for any particular f right, nij. Okay? This object is of this form when we identify this f as e to the power minus beta g squared by 2 x squared plus I times x chi I minus chi j. Right? That's clear? Okay? So, if I want to use this theorem, which I do, you'll see why. Okay? All I have to do is to compute the Fourier transform of this object. Fourier transform of this object is added e to the power k dot x to the Gaussian integral. Okay? So, what does that do? That has this chi I minus chi j plus k. Okay, then the whole thing squared. Okay, so this is just, and now you complete the square, you'll also get a Gaussian. So you do you see that up to some factors, this will be 1 over beta g squared. It's important that we get this right, because when we complete the square, we get 1 over beta g squared times
get minus sign chi I minus chi j plus k. Okay, and then applying this Percival's theorem, I got the name right. Applying this Percival's theorem to this problem converts it. I'm not going to keep track of the factors of 2 and so on, okay? That you can look up in the papers, also it's in the section. Is d chi I. This is d chi I exponential of minus 1 by beta g squared. Chi I minus chi j minus 2 pi n by k squared sum over m I n. Because you have to take the Fourier transform, replace the argument of the Fourier transform by integers, there's some 2 pi's over the place. I'm not in charge of these 2 pi's, right? Treat that as being schematic. Okay? And get this. Is it clear that the partition can be rewritten in this form? Now remember, G is very large. Okay? Earlier in the lecture, we've encountered this object. Sum over this object. Where this G is very large. Where have we encountered this?
Large.
What?
Strong.
Large in?
No.
Yes, yes, yes. We'll be taking the sample point, but I just wanted to ask, we've seen this expression before. This is an approximation for something simple. When G is very large. An approximation for what? Come on,
in the PKT, we were looking at SI dot SJ.
That kind of thing, but much more universally. It's an approximation of 1 minus cosine. This is an approximation in the large G limit. This is a very good approximation of B, chi I, as we said, explained in the earlier part of the lecture. Exponential of 1 minus cosine of chi I minus chi j. The whole thing, I'm going to put a 2 here for fun, so that. Right? Now you see the beautiful thing. The thing is irritating. The difficult thing in solving this problem was the sum of integers. Sum of integers are a pain. Integrals we can do, summing over integers never pleasant. And that's why number theory is a hard subject. Maybe for other reasons. Okay, so, but now in the approximations we got, this has been converted into an amazingly simple model. And the amazingly simple model is in fact a model we wrote down earlier in this class. It's called what? Spin system. We wrote it down in 2 dimensions, the BKT model. When you see that this has turned into the partition function of a spin system.
We don't have any of the sums anymore, A and I over here.
Yeah, this is, no, this everything is gone. This is now just, it's exactly this. Okay? This makes perfect sense. Spinners live at sites rather than at, on links. We integrated out the limit degrees of freedom by doing the sum over n. And we got an effective action for the site degree of freedom, which was the Lagrange model. By integrating out the physical stuff, we endowed dynamics to the Lagrange model. And so Lagrange multipliers turned into a spin. Okay? Now what do we see? This is exactly the partition function of a spin system, except that the temperature has come downstairs rather than upstairs. Okay? So now, we could analyze this model or we could just use what we know, right?
since we're all experts in physics, we all know that at high temperatures, a spin model has no. Let's say we're doing this in four space-time dimensions. Then how many more dimensions does the spin system live in? Three. Because the lattice was three dimensions. So this is just a discretized spin model. This is just a discretized spin model in three dimensions. And we all know that at high temperatures, if there's one phase, at low temperatures, that's the other phase. Tell me what the two phases are called.
Order and disorder.
Which is the ordered phase?
The low temperature.
Low temperature phase is ordered, where there is spontaneous breaking of symmetry and some alignment of phis in some direction. It's called planar Heisenberg model. The phis all are oriented. At high temperatures, on the other hand, there's random disorder. Exactly. I'm just talking about the ordinary spin system. So now in this model, now let's write beta as one. Beta is one of the temperatures, so we write a temperature. So we can talk about temperature and beta. So in this system at high temperatures, the system is ordered. At high temperatures, phi gets this expectation value. The chi's get an expectation. At low temperature, chi is dissolved. This thing doesn't want to stray very far away from zero. So all chi's like to be in the same direction.
No,
I'm just telling you about ferromagnetism. I'm just asking you. We could analyze this one, but I'm appealing to you to use your knowledge of ferromagnetism. You know that for a ferromagnet, at high temperature you've got disorder, at low temperature you've got order. Ferromagnetism, to understand the phase transition in general. But this we know, right? And let's not get into analyzing the model. Let's just use what we know. This, all of us know this, right? It's just that the temperature, the role of temperature has been reversed. So what we get is a phase transition in the system at some value of T of order G. So we get a phase transition in the system at some value, the temperature of order G squared. And this phase transition basically is a transition between the phase in which we've got chi ordered and chi disordered. Now let's look at this phase, this transition a little. What was chi actually? Chi was actually a Lagrange multiplier. Now, when is a Lagrange multiplier effective? You see, when is a Lagrange multiplier like this thing effective? It's effective in enforcing this delta function only when it runs over all the values it's supposed to run. If, for some reason, chi is effectively frozen over some range of values, or chi I minus chi k is effectively frozen, then this Lagrange multiplier is not doing its job. Now, this may seem like a facetious argument, but that's actually correct. And so, you see, where at high temperatures, this chi becomes ordered, the Lagrange multiplier, effectively because of dynamics, is being frozen to near a particular value. And what that effectively means is that the model this term is not play is not that that, that constraint is not very important. I know, it sounds like inverting logic in various ways. To see this clearly, what you should do is a calculation. But let me just say it again anyway. You see, what we've got is some effective potential for this guy. Okay? If chi, this effective potential, is some steep potential, sharply localizing chi to some value, then we shouldn't make too much of an error by taking the original model and replacing chi by its sharply localized value. Okay, because in the end, the dynamics is not getting substantial contribution away from those locations. Okay? So, if we were well into the magnetized phase, so very high temperatures. So that chi was chi I minus chi j is very sharply localized to zero. Okay? Or to some integer multiple of 2 pi. If this we could just replace by zero or some integer multiple of 2 pi. Right at the beginning, we shouldn't be making too much of an error. But that's integer multiple of 2 pi, or zero is the same thing multiplied by an integer. So that's like not having this term at all. Is this clear?
Okay, the fishy argument is fine by me, but you are indeed using gauge invariance.
What? The gauge invariance being the chi's?
Yeah, I mean, there is a constraint on the NIJs.
There is a constraint on the NIJs, but the issue is that constraint affecting the answer or not? The constraint is always there.
Okay.
Okay? So, what we are seeing is that in a particular regime, namely very high temperatures, that constraint is a small change on the actual answer. So the final answer you get more or less the right value by ignoring the constraint.
That seems odd, because the energy constraint happened at the level of configurations. Wasn't the argument about energies or anything?
Right.
So like some set of configurations are disallowed.
Some set of configurations.
How does the set change?
No, the set is not changing. It's just the following question. It's that those disallowed. Suppose you do two problems. First problem is sum over all configurations. Second problem is only sum over only the allowed configurations. Are those two problems giving you more or less the same answer? Okay? So the configurations that are being disallowed, are they contributing significantly to the answer or not? That's the question. Okay? And what we're seeing is that in the high temperature phase, the constraint is not making up. Now, I should emphasize that we have to go to pretty high temperatures for this to be really true. Because just having a potential is, you still have some fluctuations. But on the other hand, in a low temperature phase, chi I minus chi j is completely unconstrained. So there, ignoring, there's no sense in which we can set chi to even approximately some particular value. Okay? So in the low temperature phase, physics is dominated by the constraint. Okay? And in the high temperature phase, the constraint is not making much of a difference. Okay? This is the lattice, strong coupling lattice gauge version of a famous phase transition in continuum Yang-Mills theory. Can somebody tell me what the name of the transitions? As a function of temperature? This is a class of string theorists. No, this is a famous transition. Yeah. Sir, you were talking about transition in gravity. Okay. Yes. It's called the deconfinement transition. The deconfinement transition. It's the transition in QCD above which quarks are liberated. Actual quark states can propagate around without having infinite energy. Okay? And you understand why this is the case. You see, if this, what is the reason that a quark and anti-quark pair have an energy proportional to the length. The reason is the Gauss law. Because the core produces a flux. And because of the Gauss law, the flux has nowhere to go. So it must continue. It must continue. It must continue. Until it meets its equilibrium. Since it's going to have, therefore, flux tube of order length, that gives you the linear confining potential between the core and the medium. If the Gauss law is not important, okay, this argument no longer works. Which is really to say that the stuff can end at somewhere in the thermal sea or something like that. It's creamy, some words you can put to it. Okay? So, in the phase where the Gauss law is not dominant in physics, you might suspect, and you would be correct in suspecting, okay, that this linearity of potential is no longer correct. Okay? There are many other ways of saying this. There are let's leave it at that. Let's leave it at that. On the other hand, in the Lorentz interface, okay, this Gauss law dominates the physics. And the theory is confined. So this is a transition between confinement and deconfinement. Actually, the really convincing way of seeing this transition between confinement and deconfinement is to compute a quark, is to add a quark to this problem, add a charge to the problem, and then compute correlation functions of the charge anti-charge object in this model. This can be done. I'm not going to go through the details. You really see this transition between this linear type behavior, between confinement type behavior and deconfinement type
behavior. Okay. Sir, yes. Sir, is it somehow possible to explain the Ising model by tweaking this model? Like, instead of like chi I minus chi j, if you can get a chi I dot chi j kind of a thing somehow, then is it possible to study the Ising model?
Yeah, this is like the O2 version of the Ising. If you just restrict your chi I's to be either plus or minus 1, this is the Ising. Plus or minus 2 pi Ising. This is a continuous version of the Ising model. But I just want to say that we have not in this class done any independent analysis of these global models. I'm just appealing to your deep understanding of these models. To quickly reach the answer. Okay, I'm not claiming to have enriched your understanding of these models. I'm using your understanding of these models to understand each series. Okay, now everything I said can be generalized for SU2. That's going to be one of your other problems. Okay, when you redo this calculation for SU2, you'll see that it's not different. It's a non-abelian torque, non-abelian spin. It's quite fun. So you understand one of the utility. So I think I will not touch on lattice cage theory again in this class. Our next lecture will return to the continuum and to more mundane BRST quantizations, things like that. It's sort of boring stuff. But I had this two-lecture interlude on lattice cage theory for two reasons. Okay. First reason, which is very important, lattice cage theory is the principal tool to obtain numerically accurate results in actual gauge theories. Okay? You know, let me say this again. Okay. You know, what is the job of a theorist? For this purpose, saying, as you know, excluding numerical work from the ambit of theory. By theorist, I mean, you know, somebody who thinks the mind works out of pencil paper. What is the job of that kind of physics? A, to produce the right equations for the entities. But that's not enough. You have to have some idea of how these equations behave. However, in the real world, it's often the case that actual physical systems have equations whose behavior are so complex that pen and paper work will never, not till the end of the universe, but produce exact results for most questions we're interested in answers from. So if you have a purist's notion of the idea of a theorist, okay, you should get the exact answer with pen and paper. For most problems of interest, you don't do that much. The job of the theorist is first, find the right equations. But secondly, this is another very important thing, is to populate the space of mathematical models with solvable points. So that by looking at every solvable point in the space of theories, you can get qualitative expectations for some non-solvable point. And then, if you're really interested in the numbers, then you make a case of it. Okay? So this lattice gauge theory has played both roles. Okay? Firstly, of course, its primary use is that it is the principal technique for actually numerically simulating a very hard problem that we can never do otherwise. If you want the spectrum of mesons in the real world, the spectrum of protons, the mass of the proton, how would you ever compute it otherwise, really, if you wanted to really know? That's one thing. One thing. But there is a second use of lattice gauge theory that I wanted to emphasize in my two lectures. As giving a system which you can deform away from the theory that you're interested in, namely the actual continuum theory, to solvable points, like the strongly coupled limit, like this case. Then when you go to these solvable points, you can ask in those deformations the analogues of questions that are of great interest but of great difficulty in the actual theory. Okay? This problem, the problem of deconfinement, is a problem of experimental interest. So very, that actual Young's theory is a function of temperature undergoes a phase transition. Confining to deconfining. It was a very important, beautiful phenomenon. It was key to, say, early universe physics. Okay, it's a very, very important thing. Great importance to understand the real world. You see, by taking the lattice gauge theory, going away from the end of interest, the end of interest is the weakly coupling, because that's what it approximates to. But on the lattice, there is a vector of the limit. The other end is stronger. There, you see, in fine lines, we could solve the problem of thermodynamics, find the deconfinement transition, and put equations to this phenomenon and this problem, and so understand it more deeply. Okay? This is the kind of thing a theorist should be doing. Okay? To understand deconfinement, how else will you proceed? This is the kind of thing you should be doing. So that was the other use of lattice gauge theory that is somehow underemphasized in education. Of producing classes of models which can be deformed away from the problem of interest and then solved to give you great intuition for what might actually be happening where the problems of interest. Okay? So this is the angle that I tried to emphasize in my I didn't try to amaze you with my numerical abilities if I mean something. Okay? This was something that an activity that happened with great vigor in the 1970s and the 80s, especially in the 1980s. It continues in the tradition of condensed matter more than that in energy physics. Now, it was maybe a lot of fun. Okay, but anyway, as from the point of view of the energy physicists, this is largely an exercise for fun now. It's hardly ever used. It may turn out to be used. Anyway, so I'm going to move away from this discrete model studying. Back to the continuum. Next class. Any questions or comments? Please.
Sir, we didn't talk about the weak coupling limit.
Yeah. We only spoke about the strong coupling limit because that is the limit that we could easily understand. Now, the weak coupling limit.
Then the first term would drop, right?
Yeah. The weak coupling limit would be a limit. The weak coupling limit would be a limit where the kinetic term is a perturbation on the potential term. And that then of course becomes quite a difficult
problem. Yeah. So why can't we just throw it away, like we use the same logic to throw away the potential term in the strong coupling limit? So in the weak coupling limit, why can't we just ignore, like, not consider the kinetic term? The logic
because
is,
No, because that's singular. You see,
it's like this.
Suppose we've got quantum mechanics. And and we had potential. Okay. Suppose we had quantum mechanics and we had some potential that was very steep. Be better than kinetic term. Then we can get some wave function that is very highly localized. Okay. And in some extreme limit, this thing will go to some effective delta function. We'll go to that effective delta function. However, p square evaluated really on a delta function is infinite. So, it will never really be a delta function. There will be some smearing, and in that smearing, p squared and the potential will always contribute comparatively. Let's look at a harmonic oscillator. Let's look at a harmonic oscillator at very large k. Let's look at ground state wave function. It's always true as an exact statement that half of the energy comes from kinetic and half of the energy comes from the potential. So you can never really know the kinetic. Because what this does is start squeezing the wave function, and as you squeeze it more, the momentum starts contributing more and more. And the size of the wave function is such that there is a balance between the two. Okay. So actually the weakly coupled problem is a very complicated problem from this point of view. Of course, all of these problems in the 80s have been analyzed, and there must be some attempt at analysis of this. But I'm not aware of it. I could look it up. Okay, the Schrödinger problem on the other hand was very simple because it made free quantum mechanics. That's why we analyze things. Very simple. Okay, other questions? Okay, yeah. Okay, very good. So in the next class we will try to turn to the renormalization of the computation of the beta. Somebody knows what to do with this thing.